So this is what we discussed last time. We had new definitions. We redefined momentum, which we said p is equal to m times u, where u is the velocity of the particle. M is actually m naught multiplied by gamma u, which is has been given here, this particular expression which has been given there. This is the gamma u. Now this we said that this in the classical limit, which means when the velocity of the particle is much smaller in comparison to the speed of light, will reduce to the classical expression of momentum. This we went rather very hurriedly last time, but it's rather easy to see that all that will happen, that gamma u will, because when your u is much smaller than c, this factor m will be essentially equal to m naught, and this expression reduces to the classical expression of momentum, which is m naught times u. Then we defined the energy E is equal to mc square, and then that's the time we said that this energy, on the other hand, if you make speed very small in comparison to speed of light, will not reduce to the classical energy, because this is a totally new concept of energy. We said that actually the kinetic energy should be regarded as the difference of mc square and m naught c square, because according to this particular definition of energy, even if the particle is at rest, this particular particle possesses the energy which is equal to m naught c square, and this m naught, which is rest mass, is supposed to carry all other forms of energy, and therefore this E is also supposed to carry all other forms of energy. For example, if the particle becomes hot, in principle it gains energy, and if it gains energy, so its m naught should go up. So this is what we discussed last time. Now there is one particular point which I would like to connect to this particular thing, which probably will become obvious why I am doing it. And these are the relationship which we discussed, you know, relationship between momentum and the energy, and relationship between kinetic energy and the momentum. In any problem, these relationships are very important. One of the most important concept which comes from special theory of relativity, which has no classical analog, is that this gives you a possibility of a particle which has a zero rest mass. Classically, if a particle has a zero rest mass, it does not exist. It's no longer a particle. But here there is a possibility that the particle could have a zero rest mass. These are the expression which I have just now written, E is equal to mc square. Remember, m was m naught upon under root 1 minus u square by c square. Similarly, your momentum was m naught u divided by under root 1 minus u square by c square. This is the same thing which I have written in the expanded form. Now, if m naught happens to be zero, in principle, energy and momentum would be zero, because m naught appears in the numerator. So in principle, that should be zero. However, there is a possibility that if denominator also becomes zero, then this energy and momentum will both become zero by zero, and zero by zero need not be equal to zero. It could also have a finite value. So it means that there is a possibility that if there is a particle which has a zero rest mass, then this particular particle could possess energy as well as momentum, okay? But in that case, relativity will allow that only if this denominator also becomes zero, and that will become zero only when u becomes equal to c. It means that particular particle must travel with speed of light. So it gives you a possibility, relativity gives you a possibility of a particle with zero rest mass, which could possess energy, which could possess momentum, but must travel with speed of light. It cannot travel with any other speed, because otherwise it will be inconsistent with the special theory of relativity. And as all of you know, that this particular particle is generally called a photon. Actually, one of such particles is photons. As we all know, that photons, in principle, I mean, photon is, we always believe it to be light, and it has to travel with the speed of light, because this is light. Therefore, this particular photon will have energy, which we know from our old classical photoelectric effect, that it has the energy h nu. The only thing which I would like to say, that if you go to this particular expression, which is E square is equal to P square C square plus M naught square C to the power 4, if M naught happens to be 0, then the relationship reduces to E square is equal to P square C square. It means the momentum of the particle must be given by E by C. So the particle momentum must be equal to E by C. So therefore, if everything is consistent with special theory of relativity, then this photon can be treated as a particle with zero rest mass. Of course, it has energy h nu, which we know from other experiments. Then it should also have a momentum which is equal to h nu by c. And we believe that light consists of photons. In fact, it's a slightly a dilemma, because when we started our relativity lessons, we always start by looking at the light and realizing that light is actually an electromagnetic wave, and therefore it must travel with a speed which is given by under root 1 upon under root epsilon naught mu naught. And then suddenly we come back and talk of a totally different language and try to say that, well, light actually consists of particles. This looks contradictory, but this is unfortunately what is true in the nature, that light does seem to have a dual nature. Light sometimes behaves like a particle, it behaves sometimes like a wave, as all of us know. This is what we call as a dual nature of light. Okay, there are experiments like interference, diffraction, polarization, which can be much better understood on the basis of the wave theory, but there are experiments like photoelectric effect and the Compton effect that we are going to describe today, which are much better understood only on the particle nature of the light. It shows a dual nature, and that's what is basically the culprit for us to land in quantum mechanics. Now, I'm sure all of you would have heard about photoelectric effect experiment, which I'm not going to describe. There is only one aspect of photoelectric effect which I want to tell. So, photoelectric effect was one of the key experiment, one of the direct evidence that light behaves like particles, behaves like, it consists of photons which have energy h nu. But on the other hand, this particular experiment cannot really prove that it has a momentum equal to h nu by c. Okay, let me just try to explain this particular aspect a little bit more. See, first thing, I made a statement rather hurriedly last time, which I will probably like to emphasize again, that for example, if you take a free electron, let's suppose, I mean, if at all we can create an electron at rest, okay, we can show that it can never absorb a photon. It means, see, what is photoelectric effect? It's basically a photon gets absorbed and its energy is transferred to electron. All right. Now, is it possible that there is a free electron and it absorbs a photon, and whatever is its energy, this particular electron gains? Okay. It's always possible, because this is a conservation of energy, but we can show that if that happens, and if this particular photon has a momentum h nu by c, then momentum conservation will not be valid. And as we have said, that for any process to be valid, both energy and momentum has to be conserved. So you can show very, very easily. Okay, you try it yourself. If you have difficulty, I can probably help you, but it's a very, very simple way of looking at that. First, write energy. You write h nu is equal to kinetic energy of the electron. Then write momentum h nu upon c and try to solve these equations. You'll never be able to solve these equations. Okay, it means it's not possible for conservation of energy and conservation of momentum both to hold good for a free electron, so that it could absorb a photon. It means photoelectric effect is never possible with respect to a free electron. However, there are two things which are possible. One thing which is possible, that this particular electron is actually bound to an atom, okay, which is actually the way actual photoelectric effect experiment takes place, because certain amount of energy of the photon is used for releasing this particular electron, and the balance of the energy is given to kinetic energy. That particular process becomes possible. There is another possibility which we will describe today, is that the photon gives only part of its energy to the electron and not complete energy to the electron. That's also a process which is possible, which is called Compton effect. Okay, so we have two possibilities, that either we let this particular electron get bound, okay, and therefore photon uses part of its energy to make this particular electron free, and only remaining balance of the energy it gives as a kinetic energy to the electron. Or number two, the photon does not get completely absorbed, it gives only part of its energy to the electron, and as a result you still get a photon but with a reduced energy and electron with a higher energy, which is what is called Compton effect. So these two processes are possible. But the point which I was trying to discuss it, because this particular electron, if we have to observe in photoelectric effect, has to be bound to an atom, and atom is much heavier in comparison to electron. Therefore, you will never be able to see conservation of momentum. For example, just to give an example, if I perform an experiment, throw a ball towards this particular wall, and this ball comes back, okay, to you it would appear as if the momentum is not conserved, because the ball momentum initially was in this particular direction, it has changed its direction, okay, so it appears that momentum is not conserved. Strictly speaking, momentum is conserved, but the fact is that the difference of this particular momentum has been taken by this particular wall, and this wall is rigidly connected to Earth, and it's almost impossible to measure the change in the speed of the Earth, which is so heavy, which is so massive, okay, and really test whether conservation momentum took place or not. So a precisely similar situation lies when I am talking of photoelectric effect, because this particular electron is bound to a much more heavier atom. Okay, so if a photon gets absorbed, and if I want to really test whether momentum conservation has taken place or not, okay, the entire atom will recoil and it will probably change its energy very, very little, and therefore it will be very difficult to measure how much recoil has taken place, and therefore you will not be able to test the conservation of momentum. So unfortunately, photoelectric effect, though it's a very good experiment to tell that photons carry energy h nu, but to test the second aspect about the momentum, which should come from relativity, because if it has the energy h nu, if it can be treated as a particle with zero rest mass, it should also have a momentum which is equal to h nu by c. Okay. By the way, let me just tell you that, you know, probably you are aware that the fact that light carries momentum was known much earlier, much before relativity was discovered. People knew that light does carry momentum. There have been experiments which were done earlier, and it was realized that, you know, light does carry momentum. But here we are treating into a particular formalism using special theory of relativity, when we are saying that if it has energy h nu, it must have a momentum of h nu upon c if this particular particle has a zero rest mass. Fortunately for us, it's the Compton effect which can give this particular information. It can test that photon is really having a momentum of h nu by c, because then basically you're requiring a lighter particle, and if you're having a lighter particle scattering, then as I said, unfortunately, you cannot absorb the photon completely. You have to only absorb the photon's energy partially. So this is basically what is called as a Compton effect experiment. Here you have an electron which you are assuming to be free, and or rather at rest, and there is a photon which is coming incident from the left hand side with energy h nu, and once this particular photon interacts with this particular electron, as an outcome you will find that another photon comes out which has a reduced energy, which gets scattered at an angle theta from the original direction, and electron also gets scattered at an angle of phi. This electron, which was originally at rest, is no longer at rest, but starts moving with a particular kinetic energy. Now we will apply conservation of energy and conservation of momentum to this particular problem and work out what should be the energy of the photon. Okay, and if we can experimentally verify whatever we get the energy from this particular thing, then we have sort of understood that really it's true that photon carries the momentum. Okay, it carries the energy, and whatever expressions we have obtained relativistically, those expressions seem to be correct. Alright. So I'll not go into the detail about mathematics as I said, but let us just discuss the physics out of it. So what we will do, that first we'll conserve momentum, and because momentum is a vector quantity and each component has to be separately conserved. So let's call this as x direction, this is a y direction. So we will write the momentum along the x direction. The original momentum along the x direction was only because of this particular particle, because this electron was assumed to be at rest. So original momentum was only h nu upon c, because only particle which was carrying momentum was the photon. So original momentum must be h nu by c, which is in the x direction. Original momentum along the y direction was zero. Now as a result of interaction, as a result of scattering, you have another photon which is coming out with energy h nu prime, which is here. So let's take the x component of that particular momentum, which will be h nu prime by c. If whatever I am saying is correct, if whatever relativity says is correct, then its momentum should be h nu divided by c cos theta along the x direction. Similarly, whatever is the momentum of the electron, let's assume that this particular momentum is pe. So that component along the x direction should be pe cos theta. So we'll get one equation, which is h nu upon c is equal to the momentum component of the photon and momentum component of the electron. The second equation that I will get will be along the y direction, because the y direction there is no momentum. So we take h nu prime divided by c into sin theta, which is the component along the y direction. That must balance with the y component of the momentum of the electron, which is in this particular direction. So it must be balancing pe sin theta. The third equation is conservation of energy. Of course, we have to use relativistic equations. Okay, if you use relativistic equation, you know this initial energy, even though electron was at rest, it had an energy equal to m naught c square. So original energy was h nu plus m naught c square. Now once it starts moving, m naught c square changes, it becomes mc square. Okay, mc square plus the energy, which is h nu prime, because energy is not a vector quantity, so we'll just take the total sum of the energies. So this is what I have written in the second equation. This is the first equation, is the conservation of momentum along the x direction, thing which we just now described. The second equation is the conservation of momentum along the y direction, and third is the conservation of energy, which is m naught c square plus h nu is equal to h nu prime plus e. Of course, energy and momentum are not independent of the electron. If I know the energy of the electron, momentum has to be related, and that has to be related by this equation which we have described earlier. E square should be equal to p square c square plus m naught square c to the power 4. So once we describe experiment, we will describe that it's very, very difficult to know about the recoil of the electron, to experimentally measure the recoil of the electron. Therefore, any parameter which is related to electron, we sort of eliminate from this equation. So first thing that we do is to eliminate phi. Phi is the angle at which the electron gets scattered, which, as we just now described, is a little difficult to measure. So let's get rid of this particular constant. So what we do, from this particular equation, you have PE cos phi on the first equation here. Second equation, you have PE sin phi. So you square and add. So sin square phi plus cos square phi will become 1. So you will get rid of sin square phi. Then you manipulate with other equations, and then you will finally get the result. So this is what I am doing, first thing. Eliminating phi, so I get this particular equation. Then next thing that I do is use this particular equation, p square c square is equal to e square minus m naught square c to the power 4. So I substitute p square c square, which I have got from the earlier equation here. See, here I can get multiply by c square, so I get this equation, and this is the equation which I have got, and equate from the energy conservation which I get from here. So these equations are equated here. As I said, I will not go into the mathematics. You sort of manipulate these particular expressions a little bit mathematically, and finally you get the famous Compton effect experiment expression, which is lambda prime minus lambda is equal to h upon m naught c 1 minus cos theta. Remember, theta is the angle by in which direction the photon has got scattered. So basically it tells you that if a particular photon is observed after scattering at an angle theta from the incident direction of gamma ray, or why gamma rays, that we will discuss later. Okay, from the photon, incident direction of the photon velocity, then it's changed wavelength. Okay, remember, lambda prime has to go up if the energy has to go down. See, h nu prime will have be lower than h nu. It means its wavelength will be larger. Okay, therefore, the increase in the wavelength of the photon will be given by this particular expression, h upon m naught c 1 minus cos theta. It's the famous Compton effect expression. So let us just look at this particular thing. The first thing that we realize that the wavelength increase is independent of wavelength and depends only on the scattering angle. You look at this particular expression, this increase does not depend on the lambda, it just depends on just theta. Okay, h, m naught c are fundamental constants. This lambda c is equal to h upon m naught c if m is the mass of electron, is what is called Compton wavelength of electron. And if you just put the numbers, these are all standard numbers, the value of this turns out to be fairly small, which is 2.43 into 10 to the power minus 3 nanometers. It's a fairly small value. Alright, this is what you get. You also realize that delta lambda is equal to 0 for theta is equal to 0. If you put theta is equal to 0, then cos theta is equal to 1. So there is no change. So if the photon is going directly, okay, means essentially it doesn't get scattered. If it doesn't get scattered, obviously there cannot be a change in wavelength, which is obvious. And is equal to 2 lambda times c for theta is equal to 180 degree. In fact, that's the largest change that you can have. The largest change can happen when this cos theta becomes equal to minus 1, which means theta is equal to 180 degrees. And at that time, the total change in the wavelength that you'll be getting will be twice the Compton wavelength. Now, problem is that our wavelength is so small that if you use, for example, Compton effect using the optical light, which has typically the wavelengths of the order of 5,000 angstroms, okay, to measure a change of 0.02 angstrom in that 5,000 angstrom, to devise an experiment where you can measure such a small change in such a large wavelength is going to be extremely difficult. Therefore, we normally would, though in principle, even that particular photon will get a small Compton shift in the wavelength if it gets scattered, but that will be very, very difficult to measure. So if I want to experimentally measure, it's better to use a very small lambda, it means much higher energetic photons, then only there is a possibility that I will be able to detect the change in the wavelength. So therefore, gamma rays are used whenever we perform actually an experiment with Compton effect, okay, which are comparatively much higher energies, and therefore to measure small changes in lambda becomes possible because you are never going to get change more than 0.04 angstrom. So better to use 1 angstrom, 2 angstrom, then probably you can detect, you know, this is a 4% change, which is still small, but then you can measure. or go to still lower lambdas. But in 5000 to measure change of 0.04 is going to be extremely difficult. The other thing which I wanted to also tell, that this is for electron. See, it's H upon M naught C. Okay, if I would have used heavier particle instead of, for example, neutron or an atom, the shift would have been still smaller. Alright? Though there would not have been any change in the expression, because in principle in derivation I have never used electron, I have called it electron, because most of the time we perform this experiment with electron. But on the other hand, instead of electron, it could as well be any other particle. No other property of the electron has been used other than its mass. Okay? So instead, if I change the mass of the particular particle to any other particle, the expression will still be valid. So it means if this particular electron gets scattered by, let's say, a neutron or by an atom, okay, or by nucleus of an atom, there will still be a shift, but that will be much, much smaller. So remember, proton is 2000 times approximately heavier than electron. Okay, so shift will be 2000 times lower. Okay, so essentially it will hardly, you will notice any change, because electron happens to be one of the very light particles. Therefore, it becomes easier for to perform this experiment. Shift will be the largest, and that also is not so large. Now we come to an experimental setup. As I said, there is always a gap between the way theoreticians think and the way experiment has to be done. It's very easy to say theoretically that, you know, let's put an electron at rest and let the photon comes and hits it. Okay, where do I get in a laboratory electron which is at rest? You know, it's not very easy thing to be done. And where do I get an electron which is sort of free, you know, which is not bound? Okay. Now, generally it's known that in metals there are large number of electrons which are approximately free. I'm using the word approximately free. If we discuss free electron theory, you will realize that, you know, there are shortcomings with free electron theories. So electrons cannot be 100% free even in a metal. Okay, they are bound by forces. Okay, but to a good approximation. Remember, in physics we always like to make approximation. You know, ideal situation can never be reproduced. You know, let's try to do whatever best we can do. So we choose a metallic material in which there will be large number of approximately free electrons, and let these electrons scatter the photons. So what we do, we have a metallic target as I have mentioned here, and there is an incident gamma ray beam which is coming and hitting this particular target. Alright, then you put your detector at an angle theta from the incident direction of gamma rays and you start counting. Okay, there are a lot of detectors, you know, from which you can count the number of photons, scintillation detectors, I don't even remember. But you know, those people who are working in nuclear physics probably will know that many type of detectors from which you can actually count the number of photons which are coming. And therefore, you can find out in a given time how many number of photons have been coming at that particular angle of theta. And not only that, you can also find out their wavelength or their energies. Similarly, you can keep on changing your theta slowly and slowly, and in principle find out at each value of theta what are the type of energies that you are getting and what are the numbers that you are getting. It's a very, very simple experiment otherwise. I mean, this experiment we do also in MSc, and you know, I mean, in fact, a lot of people also do a research type of experiments there. Now, this graph I have plotted roughly myself, so this may not be a very accurate graph, so please excuse me for that. If you want to look at an actual experimental graph, you have to look at the textbook. Okay, if you plot the total number of photons coming as a function of lambda for a particular theta, so I have chosen a particular theta, fix my detector at that value of theta, then I am calculating the total number of photons as a function of lambda prime, okay, the different wavelengths. What you find, surprisingly, you find two peaks. One peak is completely sharper, which is here, and another followed by another peak which is larger lambda, which is comparatively broader. All right. Now, if you perform this particular experiment at different values of thetas, what you find that the separation of these two peaks keep on changing. However, this particular lower lambda peak essentially remains more or less at the same position. All that is happening, if you increase theta, you will find out that this particular peak, which is a broader peak, that keeps on going to still a larger and larger lambda. Now, if you take lambda prime and you know what is your original lambda, lambda prime minus lambda corresponding to this high lambda peak actually satisfies the Compton effect experiment, okay, expression. Okay. However, there are two interesting observations which we realize here. First of all, we find out that the width of this particular peak is much larger in comparison to the original peak. And the second is that you find two peaks and the lower lambda peak essentially matches with the original lambda. And the way we explain this particular thing is that after all, you are using a metallic target and electrons are coming and hitting that. There is no reason that electrons will get scattered only by electrons. There are also heavier particles like nuclei. Okay, and electron has also a chance that they may get scattered at that particular value of theta after getting scattered from, let's say, nucleus. As we have just now discussed, that if they are heavier particles, the Compton shift is going to be exceedingly small. So essentially, they will give you the same value of lambda, because the change in lambda will be so small that it will be very difficult to measure. So we explain that this particular low lambda peak that I am getting in the Compton effect experiment is because of those electrons which have got scattered from the heavier particle, because almost impossible for us to isolate only electrons and perform this experiment only with electrons. This second observation is that the width of the peak is much higher of the Compton scattered electrons, which have been actually scattered from electrons, Compton scattered photons, which have been actually scattered from electrons. And the reason for that is that these electrons which we have talked about are not really at rest. In original expression of Compton effect, we have assumed that these electrons are at rest. Actually, these electrons will be moving, and they will not be moving only with a single velocity, but they will be moving with large number of velocities. There is always the distribution of velocities of the electrons inside a metal. Okay? And when you look and take their velocities into consideration, you will find that there is small changes in their lambdas of the scattered photon. So this particular enlargement of peak width that I am getting in the Compton scattered photons because of the electrons is because of the fact that there a large number of electrons with a large distribution of velocities, and that's why this particular peak gets widened. But anyway, what is the most important conclusion of that? This particular shift that I am getting is actually matching the expression which we have theoretically derived. So this was one of the experiments which conclusively proved that photons do behave like particles which have energy h nu and momentum h nu by c. So it's a very strong proof of the fact that these particular photons do carry a momentum which is actually given by h nu by c. Okay, so what we have discussed was the dual nature of light. There are certain experiments like photoelectric effect and Compton effect which seem to show that light does behave like particles. Then we have another set of experiments like interference diffraction, where the wave nature of the light comes into play. One of the biggest mystery is that how these particles have both these effects common. This is something on which we are going to spend a little bit more time, which basically realizes somewhat, I will call it somewhat a philosophical aspect. Yes.
Is it now okay to take a photoelectric effect as the proof of particle nature? Because the threshold kind of thing today with large intensity, when you have multiphoton absorption,
yeah,
those things, so those threshold will not be sharp threshold. So, is it not better to talk about black body radiation instead of photoelectric effect? When that will give more equal to h nu thing.
See, in black body radiation, in principle, the way you originally derived it, okay, you never used any particle nature of the light. You are always talking about the standing waves inside the cavity. That's the way originally black body radiation expression. See, after all, what Planck did, the density of state he took exactly same as Rayleigh and Jeans. Only thing what was different was the average energy. Alright? So, in principle, you don't require in the standard black body radiation thing a particle nature of light. But what I want to emphasize is not just the particle nature of the light. The fact that this particular energy quantum is proportional to frequency, that's what much more important. Okay, and which directly is evidence only, or was directly evidence for the first time only from photoelectric experiment. Because that was the experiment which clearly demonstrated that their stopping potential depends on frequency, which was essentially considered as the most direct evidence that these photons' energy is proportional to nu. Well, I don't think you get that direct evidence. See, now that we know about these things, now we can always find out arguments that, okay, see, this thing would not have happened if particles were not photons. Okay. But if you especially go to the classical time, this was considered as the most direct evidence. And as probably all of you know, that this particular, most of these experiments, you know, this Einstein actually had proposed this particular thing in 1905. And most of these experiments were done much later by Millikan. In fact, Millikan also got Nobel Prize for that. who could actually prove that these things, whatever Einstein had predicted, had come out to be true. So I will consider still that photoelectric experiment was much more direct evidence that energy of the photon depends on frequency. Let me put it like that. Okay. In fact, quantization comes in many ways. About quantization, I will talk a little bit more aspect today. Yeah.
So
yes.
Is there any study of direct interaction between spins? Because see, basically, photon is a boson and electron is a fermion.
When we are talking about the interaction of electron and photon, basically, these two effects are occurring. Okay. So now, is there any study between that?
Yeah, I'm not very sure. I mean, I'm pretty sure the people who are doing particle physics, they have discussed these things in details and, you know, how the actual interaction takes place. In principle, there are always scattering cross-section, you know, when this scattering takes place, you know, what are the probability of a particular type of scattering happened. I mean, I'm pretty sure, of course, that's not personally not my area, so I will not be able to tell much about it.
I have come across that spin electronics.
Spin electronics is a very different thing.
In that, what we are doing is that we are creating spin polarized.
Yeah, current.
They are optically spin polarized, the electron spin.
See, if you're talking about spin electronics, this is very different. If you need, you know, probably, I'm not sure whether Professor Suresh will talk about spintronics because he's giving one lecture on magnetism. That's a part of magnetism. Okay. Basically, normally, in the normal electrons, we talk only of the current of the electrons. Okay. We don't bother about spin. Okay. But, you know, especially with the advent of what we call as giant magnetoresistance, which was 1986. Okay. Essentially, people realize that if we could manipulate the spin of the electrons also, or produce a current which you call as a spin polarized current, which has current with electrons only of one spin, that can give rise to many more effects, especially in the memory. In fact, why it got so much of attention was because of, you know, the memories of the hard disk, you know, went up, you know, maybe drastically only because of that particular spintronic effect. But that spintronics and what you are talking, according to me, these are two different things. Because when you are talking of electron-photon interaction, that's something different. Because in a spintronic device, I'm not normally talking about the photon. I'm only talking about the electronic current. Okay? So according to me, these two are somewhat different. Yeah.
There is magnetic quantum scattering is a very well-established area, yeah. What he is talking about.
Yeah.
And these experiments are done by using the synchrotron radiations at Spring at Japan, mm-hmm. and the one at European ESRF.
Yeah.
It is a very well established area, and in that particular experiment, using the spin of the electron, complex scattering is studied.
That's what I said. See, actually, there is a different area. Unfortunately, yeah. Physics is divided into multiple areas.
Yeah.
People who do this scattering experiment, especially like using synchrotron.
Yeah.
Okay. Those are different. And generally, they are working in the area of particle physics and other things. You know, yeah. Because yeah. I'm not particle physicist, so I cannot give you direct information. Yeah.
But I know that.
Yeah. So, I'm pretty sure people will be doing that particular type of experiments. I'm pretty sure about that.
Excellent, sir.
Yeah.
Regarding this Compton effect, can we measure this zero Compton shift for theta equal to zero experimentally?
See, the thing is that anyway, I'm measuring even at theta is equal to zero, you see the only the original peak. That you can always measure. There's no difficulty. But all I'm trying to say that even if you are at a different value of theta, okay, you're always getting some photons which essentially appear to be unshifted in their wavelength. All right. So the two peaks that I'm talking here, this particular peak, is essentially more or less unshifted energy of the photon, which I'm explaining that actually we have seen that they have scattered because we are measuring them at a different angle. Okay. But the change in the energy is so small that you're not able to measure them as effectively. Obviously, if you put a direct beam, you will still get this particular type of photon. So you can always measure. But see, when you are talking how small we can measure, then it becomes very, very difficult. Because then, you know, I mean, for example, when we take a monochromatic beam of photons, as we'll be discussing now, today about uncertainty principle, you cannot have a perfectly monochromatic beam at all. Okay, there will always be a distribution of energy, there will always be a distribution, there will always has to be natural alignment, otherwise this violates uncertainty principle.
But here we are not changing the theta, theta is kept constant.
See, in this particular figure, theta is kept constant. So as I said, if I measure theta, if I change theta, for example, if I increase theta, what will happen, this peak more or less remains unshifted. But this peak goes to higher lambda values.
Can I interrupt, sir?
Yeah.
Yes, it is there. If you put 20 detectors, 20, 10, whatever you, on different angles, you will get the peaks, as sir is saying.
Yes.
It is seen in that particular experiment. You can measure it.
Yeah.
If you can vary the alignment of the detector, you can get only a single peak. that is called elastic peak, and another one is inelastic peak.
But so it will be better to use one detector and scan it along the angular position. That will be much.
But it is very difficult because the detector is very used and it is costing in Indian currency around 25 to 50 lakhs. So you have to put it on a particular angle, and that angle is to be optimized, and then you have to do it.
Okay, I think let's go ahead, you know, because otherwise, you know, we can discuss it outside, you know, some of these things which are. Yeah.
Photon effect and interference diffraction, all these. And I want to ask you something. Will you give me examples at which point a particle behaves as a wave? And you also give some example when a wave behaves as a particle. It will be better for me if you...
He thinks that I'm not very sure whether we are aware in which situation, what way a particular particle will behave. At least I'm not aware of it. So these are things which are predecided by nature, let me put it like that, you know, I mean, depending upon situation, the particles behave. So, but you know, see, examples, the more difficult point about which I will talk is how do these people, what type of problems that we'll face if these two things have to coexist, which eventually leads to uncertainty principle. That's what I would like to mention.
Okay, I'm not getting the answer properly.
No, see, the thing is that if you want me to answer this particular question, that if a particular particle is going and I want to perform an experiment, whether I can know a priori whether this is going to show a wave behavior or it's going to show a particle behavior, I do not know the answer. That's what I'm trying to say. Okay, once you perform the experiment, or once we have performed the experiment, then we know that in such a situation, the particle will behave like either a wave or a particle. But to predetermine, I'm not very sure.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah.
Is it the simultaneous property of the particle? If we say it's matter, it shows the wave and particle behavior only for one thing,
according to...
I mean, that's what is believed, and that was the famous complementarity principle, that, you know, in an experiment, both the properties cannot be simultaneously seen. People have been trying to do some experiments whether this complementary principle is violated. I'm not sure whether this anybody has done, but you know, there have been people who have been doing this particular.
Sir, being physicist, we say that thing. It is simultaneous property, only one can be identified.
That's the way it's believed. Yeah, please.
Sir, this can be better explained by taking the consideration of group velocity. When we just plot an envelope of group velocity.
I'm going to talk about group velocity today.
Then we can mention that if we just checking the group velocity, then there will be either we can find the exact location.
I'll be discussing that in more detail today. So
yeah, okay. Again, I want to interrupt.
Yes.
There was an experiment and one report on March 15 this year, in which electron behaved as a wave as well as particle. And there
it's possible. As I said, there are a lot of people who are trying to do experiment, but see, things that we always keep on publishing things, but I'm not very sure whether there is a final word on this particular thing. At least not to my knowledge. But you know, it's possible. I'm aware that there are a large number of people who are working on this particular aspect, having whether you know this particular complementary principle can be violated or not. Okay, if you have finished now, let's go a little faster now. So, what we are talking about, the second cloud. See, in earlier time, we have talked about, in my first lecture, we talked about that there are two clouds in the classical physics. One was about the motion of Earth in ether, about which we have discussed quite a bit in detail. The second was about the equipartition law. I will not go into the details of the equipartition law. But basically, this particular equipartition law was used to explain a variety of phenomena in classical physics. And three phenomena which I have listed is specific heat of gases, the specific heat of solids, and black body radiation. Earlier, at that particular time, whatever experiments were done, at least in the first two aspects of this particular thing, there was a fair amount of agreement. So it appeared that the equipartition law of energy did work for specific heat of gases and specific heat of solids in order to explain these things. However, as time progressed and we had much better data on specific heat, especially the specific heat data as a function of temperature, we realized there are discrepancies from what we got from equipartition of energy. But in older times, one of the biggest problem which was faced by people was to explain the black body radiation curve. In fact, there is a curve which is called universal black body radiation curve, which everybody is supposed to show that, you know, if you plot something as a function of something, you plot MSC power divided by T to the power 5 as a function of lambda T or whatever it is. Right? And this particular curve was something which one could not explain. There were a lot of attempts and one could not explain until Planck came. It was the first explanation of the black body radiation curve. and which was based on two very, very important assumptions, which of course at that time could not be proven. It was just a hypothesis, just a sort of phenomenology, you can call it, or you know. The two assumptions is first that the whenever there is exchange of energy takes place in a harmonic oscillator, that takes place in quantum. And this quantum of energy is proportional to the frequency. That's the second one. So there are two basic assumptions. The first assumption is that the energies are quantized. So an oscillator can only have energy h nu, 2h nu, 3h nu, 4h nu. Okay? And this quantum is actually proportional to the frequency. These are the two important assumptions. Only after these assumptions, he could find the first explanation of the black body radiation. All right? Of course, as a lot of people believe that he himself never believed in his experiments, in his theory. He was always trying to find another way, but that goes beyond the thing. Now, this particular idea of quantization was later picked by many other experiments. Again, phenomenologically, there was no real way of saying, there was no theory from which this quantization was being proven. Okay, for every system, you evolve your different quantization laws. Specific heat of solids. In fact, Einstein again published another paper where he showed that, you know, in place of, you know, the standard KT, which we normally use for equipartition law, instead of that, if you use the Planck's formula, you can at least explain why the specific heat of the solids tend to zero as temperature tends to zero. Okay, so this was one of the positive step in that particular direction. One of the very, very important positive step was Bohr's model, because we knew hydrogen spectrum very well for ages. Okay. It was fitted. People knew about reverse constant. People knew that, you know, this follows 1 upon n square plus 1 minus 1 upon n, you know, which is not, by the way, a trivial thing, because this expression is not all that simple. But still, people knew that this particular type of expression is valid. People could differentiate between these series, Lyman series, Balmer series, and all those series, but without any explanation. And at that time, Bohr was the first person who proposed this particular thing. Again, introduced quantization. Okay. Of course, he introduced quantization of angular momentum. But other than using quantization, he used everything classically. For him, the electron was really moving in a circle. Okay. So instead, angular momentum quantization, energy also automatically gets quantized. Radii also get automatically quantized. Okay. But because the quantization was comparatively simpler in comparison to angular momentum, he started with angular momentum quantization. That angular momentum of the electron must be equal to n h cross, and from that particular thing he derived various type of energy expressions, and they provided a very good explanation of all these hydrogen line spectrum, which is considered as a wonderful success. Of course, the basic problem still remains, why the oscillators or why the angular momentum gets quantized as n h cross. And what is interesting, as probably all of you know, that the quantization of angular momentum is not correct. The energy which you obtained is still correct. That still can be quantum mechanically derived, but the expression of angular momentum is not correct, because angular momentum of electron now depends on a different quantum number, as all of you know. All right. Now let's just try to talk about quantization per se. Let's just try to discuss, as I said, a little more philosophical aspect. If you go philosophically, I think there is nothing very surprising about quantization. There are many things which are quantized in the world. As we say that, you know, for example, monetary system is quantized, you know. We can never make a transaction which is, you know, smaller than a paisa. It has to be a multiple of paisa. Okay, you cannot give somebody 0.1 paisa or 0.2 paisa. That's not possible. Okay, every monetary system is quantized. Physically also, there are many other systems which are quantized, though we never use this word quantization earlier. Okay, I'll give you some examples. For example, when we did a black body radiation curve, we said only certain frequencies which form a standing wave can propagate inside the cavity. In a way, that was also quantization, because you are allowing only certain frequencies to be traveling inside the system. One more important thing is the vibration of a string. See, if you have a musical instrument, you know that there is a natural frequency with which you tune it, depends on tension and mass per unit length. This is a standard expression, and frequency is equal to n upon 2 under root t by m. Okay, there also you realize that only selected frequencies can travel which satisfy this boundary condition, that displacement of the string must be zero at this end and must be zero at this particular end. In that way, also this was also quantization, because you are allowing only certain frequencies to travel inside this particular string. And how does this quantization, though people never use the word quantization at that time, But how does this quantization come? Because we applied certain boundary conditions. And the boundary conditions is that the displacement here is 0, displacement here is 0. Okay? Which forces that this particular string must travel, must have frequencies which are satisfying this particular equation. So they get quantized. Not every frequency can travel. Only this frequency, N1, N2, N3, N4, or N1, N2, N3, or whatever it is. Only those frequencies can travel inside this particular system. So in a way, this particular application of boundary condition led to a quantization. All right? So in that sense, quantization by its own self existed earlier, though we never talked about it in that clear manner. In a way, frequencies that can be excited in a string are quantized. The boundary condition has limited the frequencies in the string to certain number of discrete values. All right. Now, let's assemble our thought. Let's imagine that we are at that particular time where things seem to be essentially in dark. So, let's just try to assemble our thought. The electromagnetic wave show dual nature. We have discussed that light seems to be showing dual nature. Sometimes it shows a particle nature, sometimes it shows a wave nature. We discuss many experiments where particle nature is clear. Classically, experiments involving interference, diffraction are explained purely on wave nature of the electromagnetic wave. Second thought, nature loves symmetry. In relativity, massive particle and photons are governed by the same equation. Photons can behave like particle or wave depending upon the experiment. That's what we just now discussed. Isn't it logical to assume that massive particle may also have some wave property? All right, if there is a symmetry in the nature, if massive particles and massless particles obey same equation relativity, is it possible that the massive particles also have wave nature? After all, photons seem to have dual nature. So, is it not possible that the particles also have a dual nature? If the particles could have wave properties, if at all, then these waves could also be subjected to some boundary conditions. We have just now seen, after all, see, light was put subjected to some boundary condition. We got some selected frequencies in a cavity. Okay? Normal wave, traditional sound wave. Okay? We clamped the two ends of the string. Okay? It allowed certain quantization of frequencies. Okay? So, if the particles could have wave properties, then these waves could also be subjected to some boundary condition. There is a possibility that you could subject them to some boundary condition, depending upon the problem, whatever problem you are describing. These boundary conditions may then limit the wavelength, like we have seen in our earlier cases. All right, it's possible. You know, we are just assembling our thoughts. And in case this wavelength depends on energy, then energy will also get quantized. Okay, so this is the way we are putting our thought process, that maybe particles behave like waves, and if this wavelength depends on energy, and if this they are the whole system subject to certain boundary conditions, then eventually you may limit the frequencies or wavelengths of these particular waves, which are particle waves, and in that case the energy may automatically get quantized. Essentially, using these ideas, de Broglie, in fact recently in French the pronunciation is de Broglie. Most of the people call it de Broglie. So, in 1924, he proposed that probably particles also behave like waves. And he used this particular expression, lambda is equal to h upon p. See, remember the expression h nu upon c is valid for photons. Okay. So, lambda is equal to h upon p will be valid both for photons and also for massive particle. While h nu upon c will be valid only for photons. Because a massive particle does not travel at the speed of light. Okay. So, this particular expression, lambda is equal to h upon p, p is valid both for photons and particles, while h nu upon c is valid only for photons. This is what he proposed. Later, it was experimentally verified. Of course, these are some certain things which I think let's skip. You know, probably you all know that actually he was trying to fit a stationary wave into the Bohr's orbit, realizing why, what is so special about the Bohr's orbit, and that's how he landed onto this particular expression. And also, just to give you the order of magnitude of the wavelength, realizing that for massive particle, the wavelength, I mean, for normal bigger particle, macroscopic particle, if you talk of cricket ball, the wavelengths are going to be so small that you'll never be able to measure it. Only for very lighter particles, like fundamental particles, the wavelength will be of that particular order, which can be typically measured. For example, if you take for electron, a thermal electron means the electron which has typically the energy of 3 by 2 kT, T is the room temperature. In that case, its wavelength will be of the order of an angstrom. It means these electrons in principle could be diffracted. Okay, because the typical interatomic spacings in a solid is also of the order of an angstrom. So if you have a wave of wavelength of the order of an angstrom, this particular wavelength can be scattered. So then there was a subsequent experiment by Davison and Germer and later by G.P. Thompson, who showed that electrons actually can be diffracted. Of course, as you are probably all aware, that electrons are actually diffracted. Electron diffraction, X-ray diffraction, neutron diffraction, these are very well-known techniques, experimental techniques, which are available to all the experimental physicists. In fact, I normally always show a typical electron diffraction diagram to the students, just to show, see, this is the diagram. You can see rings here, which are basically because of electron diffraction, which obey exactly the same condition, 2d sin theta is equal to n lambda, which actually were originally derived for the case of X-rays. So electrons do behave like waves. Now let us discuss a little bit about more of a wave. If there is a wave which is associated, going to be associated with a particle, what property it could happen? Normally when we talk of a wave, an ideal wave is something like this, which is given by A sin kx minus omega t. Yes.
Sir, you mentioned that for a particle, if we assume that energy depends on the wave, and if there is a proper boundary condition where we can put the boundary condition in the wave, the energy will be quantized, because energy depends on the frequency of the wave. If I extend the same argument to photon, then suppose a photon is free, there is no boundary condition here. So from that argument, I should say that energy is not quantized.
No, see, I'm not sure that this argument, how far you can take. No, as I said, these are only basically the thoughts which we are trying to incorporate. Photons, unfortunately, cannot be normally dealt with the normal quantum mechanics, because these particular particles, you know, see, typical Schrodinger equation is only non-relativistic. And photon, because it travels, speed of light is not there. And for that, you require a totally different type of dynamical principle. So therefore, which is definitely not in the scope of this particular thing. So I'll not be able to tell. But the thing is that, you know, I mean, it's true that if you are looking at the, let me put it like that, if you are looking at the symmetry of the arguments which we normally always give, okay, this is probably more to realize, go from the historical aspects, okay, but they cannot always be carried too far. But the fact is that, I mean, even if you're talking about the wave mechanics happens to be only one part of the quantum mechanics. I mean, in principle, it's not really necessary for many of the system to at all talk about the wave nature and still get into the quantization of the energy. Okay, because, you know, so for example, harmonic oscillator can be solved purely by using operators. Okay, so in that sense, you know, I mean, many of these things, they are a good starting point, especially if you put it like that, they are a good convincing point to a freshers. Okay, but many of these arguments cannot be 100% carried forward to ultimate in that sense. You know. So this is a sort of a normally a sine wave. We normally define what we call as a wave vector, which probably all of you know, but you know, normally we tell students, because most of the time when they come out of high school, they are generally used to talk in terms of frequency and lambda when they talk about the wave. They are, while in the quantum mechanics, or generally in most of the time physics, we use k and omega and not mu and lambda. So I take some time to define this particular wave vector k, which is 2 pi by lambda, and omega is equal to 2 pi into nu, which makes the wave equation a little simpler, a sine kx minus omega t. So that's what we normally use. And then we define what we call as a phase velocity. It means if you find out how much time it takes for a particular wave to travel. In fact, I define what I mean by velocity. So I said, you know, at a later time, if the wave moves to the dotted line, then I can calculate how much is the distance. Okay, and this distance divided by the time it takes to move from here to there will be actually called what we call as the phase velocity, and that's given by omega by k. I also try to sort of insist and try to tell them that, can you tell me what is the direction in this particular wave will be moving? And I always say that if you have, it basically depends on the sine of x and t term, because if you take sine kx minus omega t, then what happens, in order to have the same value of phi, okay, same value of displacement, okay, if time increases, x has also to increase. Therefore, this particular wave travels in a positive x direction. While if you go to this particular case, where it's kx plus omega t, and if I want to retain same psi value, then as time increases, x has to decrease. Therefore, this particular wave will actually be traveling in minus x direction. This is generally useful when we talk about, you know, when we are taking step potential and we try to describe the direction of velocity to the particles. It's basically the sine difference of the x term and the t term, which will determine in which direction a wave moves. So this particular thing which no people know, but don't the students generally are not very well aware. So I try to emphasize on this particular thing. Yes.
This wave equation.
Yeah.
We usually represent using sine, cosine.
Yes.
But wave equation we represent using the
real part, there is cosine of kx minus omega t or kx plus omega t.
Yes.
And we don't represent by sine because the imaginary part we just...
No. Here I have not even introduced complex numbers. See, thing is that as far as sine wave is concerned and a cosine wave is concerned, they just differ by phase. Nothing happens. Okay, if I am talking of sine k, I prefer sine kx because at x is equal to 0, you know, this shows displacement 0. If I am taking a cosine wave, then at x is equal to 0, this will show the maximum amplitude. So that's only the difference. See, I have not introduced the imaginary numbers at all at this particular moment. I am talking of a very, very traditional classical wave. Of course, I mean, see, if we use the imaginary numbers, we have to use the imaginary, we are rather forced to use the imaginary numbers when we are talking of wave mechanics. Okay, but many times we also use imaginary number for the convenience. For example, we use electrical circuits and we use AC waves, okay, AC passing through that. We represent it by complex numbers and then we talk about real part and imaginary part. Here I am not talking of any of those things. Here I am talking only a real sine wave. Okay. Now this can be represented by, and if you are not very happy, you can always talk about cosine wave. Nothing of physics will change or nothing of what arguments I am giving will change if sine is replaced by cosine. It depends on just one's own likeliness. Okay. So, is also in the electrical circuits, instead of real parts, if you start talking about imaginary parts, nothing will change. So, we always talk in terms of real parts, but we could also talk in terms of imaginary parts. Okay. Similarly, in quantum mechanics also, the way I am choosing, I can always choose the opposite sign, I will get the same results. Nothing of that will change. We use a convention to define that way. That's a different question.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Now then we sort of introduce that actually none of the wave is a real, none of the wave that we come across in real are actually a wave of the type which we have described earlier, in which the displacement is supposed to be true for all values of x and for all values of time. All waves are limited in space as well as limited in time. Any realistic wave cannot be of this particular form, which will vary for all values of x and for all values of time. So therefore, the actual wave or physical wave is something, or what we call as a realistic wave, is something like this, which we call as a wave group or a wave packet, in which displacement of the particles does not last forever and does not last for all values of x. It's limited both in space as well as in time. Now, if we create a wave like this, basically the question that we want to answer is that what will be the wave or this particular wave packet, whether it will be moving with the same wave omega by k as we have been talking earlier, or a different wave, a different speed. And the second question is that how can we form such a wave packet? How can we form such a realistic wave group? So this is where I spend a little bit of time. So, as most of the textbook do, we start with a standard Beats problem. We take two waves, two sine waves. You can again take two cosine waves if you want, with slightly different values of k and slightly different values of omega, a well-known Beats phenomenon which all of the students know in high schools. Okay, and when you superimpose these two waves, essentially you get a wave of this particular type, where you have a cosine term which becomes a part of the amplitude, because its delta k is small, so its wavelength is very, very small. So this will essentially modulate the amplitude of the waves, and basically your carrier wave, which is sine, represented by sine term, will still be present. So this is something, a wave which like to move something like this. And at that particular time, I start describing of two different type of velocities, one which is the velocity of the original wave, and the second, the velocity with which this amplitude or the envelope is traveling. So I have just a small sort of a clip which I will show. So it's exactly the same thing which I am allowing to move as a function of time. Okay, there are two situations which I have written there, one on the top, another on the bottom. Let us focus our first attention on the bottom wave. If we focus our attention on the bottom wave, see, I have put two black spots. If you look, one is here, another is here. Okay, this particular black spot here tells with what speed this envelope is moving. This particular black spot tells with what speed the original waves are moving, okay, which created this particular spot. Now we concentrate our attention to the top one. If we concentrate our attention to the top one, you realize that these two black spots are moving with a different velocity. For example, this black spot, which the envelope velocity is going only this much, while you remember the original velocities are going much, much larger. So this particular point is moving much faster than this particular black point, which is moving with much smaller velocity. While in this particular case, you find that this and this both are moving with the same velocity. So essentially, you tell the idea that it's possible to create a situation in which this envelope is moving with a different velocity than the original carrier waves. All right, is my point clear? Whatever I'm trying to say. Now, question is that with what speed the envelope moves? If I have to look at the speed with which the overall envelope moves, then I have to look at this particular term, which is in the square bracket, which is actually amplitude modulating, which is modulating its amplitude, which is given by this particular term. And the wave vector of this particular envelope is given by delta k. The omega of this particular envelope is given by delta omega. So if I have to look at the envelope velocity, see, like the velocity of the carrier wave depended on omega and gamma, the speed of this particular envelope will depend on delta omega by delta k. So it's basically the group velocity, this is what we call as group velocity, will depend on d omega dk. Now, it so happens that in high school, we come across most of the waves in which omega turns out to be proportional to k. It means the speed of wave does not depend on the wavelength. Then group speed and the phase speed can be same. It means the envelope speed and the speed of the carrier waves may be same. But in many of the waves, also with the particle waves, and for that matter, even elastic waves inside a solid, this does not happen. Omega actually is a function of k. The speed does depend on the wavelength, and in that case, the group speed and the phase speed can be different. Now, why it's important? So this is the value of the group speed, which we call as d omega dk. Of course, it has to be evaluated at a particular value of k. Is it the same as phase speed? Yes, if omega is equal to vk, it means with v is constant. In other words, the speed is not wavelength dependent. Now, in order to say what is the significance of this envelope speed, why we at all talk about the speed of this particular envelope, I come to the concept of how I can localize a particular wave. If I have to localize a particular wave, because people normally at the first year level would not know Fourier transform, so I essentially want to introduce them in a very, very indirect fashion. So I said, consider two mechanical waves of wavelength 10 millimeter and another of 11 millimeter, and let's see, put p is equal to 0. So I mean, I'm not talking of the time dependent term in the wave. If we superimpose, then we realize that, so the wave will be given by this psi 1 and this psi 2. Let's superimpose. So if we superimpose, this is what we'll be getting. Now, my question is that value of x is equal to 0, this particular wave would be giving you maximum implication. Here, I have taken a cos wave because this is a little easier for me to put my argument. So, if I put x is equal to 0, my amplitude will be equal to a1 plus a2. Now, at what other value of x, I will get my amplitude as a1 plus a2. So it's very easy to see that I will get amplitude a1 plus a2 after 110 millimeter, because first one has a 10 millimeter, another has a wavelength of 11 millimeter. Both of these cosines have to become 1 at the same time, at the same value of x. Okay, then only it's possible that amplitude will again become a1 plus a2. That will happen only after 110 mm. Now, instead of two waves, if I add three waves, I add one more wave, which has a wavelength of, let's say, 13 millimeter. Okay, in that case, if I have the amplitude, a1 plus a2 plus a3 at x is equal to 0, next time my amplitude will become a1 plus a2 plus a3 only after a distance of 10 multiplied by 11 multiplied by 13. Which essentially means that if I could really impose infinite number of waves which are slightly varying in their wavelength, then in that case, if once my amplitude has become 1, the second time when it becomes sum, it will essentially be shifted to infinity, it will tend to infinity. And therefore, I'll be able to completely localize the wave packet. So essentially, a localized wave packet is a combination of sine waves with different values of omegas and k's. So this is a point which I want to emphasize at this particular point. And then I just give this particular expression that there is a standard thing which is called Fourier transform, from which you can actually determine these amplitudes of these particular waves, knowing a particular type of wave packet. Now I try to introduce these two things, saying that let's suppose we have a classical wave packet. which is associated with the particle. Now, when I want to try to mix these two ideas, what type of problems I have? Classically, we assume that a particle is a localized entity, while again a classical wave is an extended entity. If I talk of a particle, if a particle is kept here, okay, I have to send some signal there in order to detect the property of the particle. Okay, either I have to send a light signal or any other type of signal, something it is localized here, particle is lying only here, it's not here, it's not here, it's only localized there. But if you look at, let's say, an ocean wave, the ocean wave could be a very, very long wave. You know, a person could be standing at that particular point in ocean, another person could be standing at this particular point in ocean. Both will see, simultaneously see waves in front of coming here. So wave will be observed there also, wave will be observed there also. But as far as the localized particle is concerned, it's observed only at a particular point. So the classically, a particle is always believed to be a localized entity, while wave is supposed to be extended entity. Now, if I have to mix these two ideas, how do I mix together? So that's what I've written. Classically, a particle is localized in a certain region of space, while an ideal wave is not. In order to detect the property of a particle, some signal must be received from the point of localization. For example, color. If I want to know what is the color of this particular point, I have to send a light signal. When it gets reflected, comes to our eye, then only I can find out what is the color of this particular particle. An ideal wave is infinite. People sitting in different places far away from each other can simultaneously detect the presence of the wave. How can these contradicting properties coexist in a quantum particle? If a particle has to behave like a wave, okay, how can these things coexist? We had earlier said that a realistic wave is like a wave packet and has somewhat localized. We even said that the wave associated with a particle is expected to be a form of wave packet. This is what we have already said, that any wave which is realistic has to be a sort of wave packet. So it has to be localized. All right. Nevertheless, I cannot localize it completely. It has to have some finite extent. And if it has to have some finite extent, wherever this particular finite extent is lying, in principle, the property of the particle can be detected there. If this is a wave packet which is representing a particle, somebody may perform an interference experiment here and detect the property of the particle. Somebody may perform an interference experiment here and can detect the particle property there. So long this particular wave represents this particle, and this wave, whatever might be the finite extension, okay, whatever is the extension, particle property can be detected there. I can find the presence of particle here. Another person sitting here performing another experiment here can find a particle property partly. Nevertheless, whatever is the extent of the wave packet, the particle properties can be detected there. So the position of the particle is uncertain to the order of the length of the wave packet. In fact, therefore, I can never be very precisely sure where my particle is lying. A particular person sitting here will perform an experiment here and say, my particle, I have found particle here. Another person sitting here, okay, will say, I found particle here, like a wave. Person sitting here will say that, okay, I saw the wave here. Person standing there also will say that I found the wave here. Both are correct. Okay, so it means wave is uncertain. Similarly, the particle property also becomes uncertain. So this is what situation I have depicted. You have an ideal wave which has infinite extension. So person sitting here, standing here, everywhere he detects the wave. I have localized it further. Now this particular person does not detect the particular property of the wave here. I have localized this further. Now these two particles, persons don't see particle, only this person sees. More and more I localize, okay, position of the particle becomes more and more certain. All right. But in order to localize, I have to use more and more wavelengths to localize more and more. Okay. Now if I do that, what will happen? If I take a perfect ideal wave, its lambda is precise. If I have mixed two waves, lambda of 10 millimeter, 11 millimeter, okay, it's uncertain. Wavelength is uncertain. It's 10 millimeters, 11 millimeters, as well as 11 millimeters. And when I have used infinite number of waves to create an infinite wave packet, okay, essentially all the wavelength is uncertain. You cannot define a unique wavelength for a wave packet. And what is wavelength related to? By de Broglie wavelength, momentum. It means more I make it compact, more my momentum becomes uncertain. So I can make position more and more precise only at the cost of making momentum more and more uncertain. On the other hand, if I want my momentum to be very certain, I have to use only one wave. Then my position becomes completely uncertain. So this is basically what is uncertainty. Shorten the wave packet, We can shorten wave packet to any amount by superposing ideal waves of a larger and larger range of wavelengths. But a unique value wavelength can be assigned only to an ideal wave. Larger range of wavelengths means their wavelength becomes more uncertain. As wavelength is related to the momentum of, by de Broglie relationship, the momentum becomes more and more uncertain for shorter waves. This is the basis of uncertainty principle. An ideal wave has a precise wavelength and hence its momentum is very precise. But when this wave extends from plus infinity to minus infinity, hence there is an infinite uncertainty in position. More we want to localize the wave packet, we make the position of the particle more precise, but then lose control on the precision of its momentum. Uncertainty principle protects wave particle duality. This is something which I'll discuss a little bit more. Yes.
So if we are using infinite number of waves, then
after the superposition, as you have said, the two peaks will be separated to infinity. But that will again mean that the wave packet is spread till the infinity.
No, see, I mean, if you put really infinite numbers, it will be 100% localized. There is nothing like infinity in the real sense. See, that particular example was given only to just prove without actually talking about the Fourier transform. Okay. I think I'll stop here.